This is the American Law Journal.
9 states plus the District of Columbia have now okayed same-sex marriage. What will this Supreme Court do? Are we ready to see history in the making? Good evening. This is the American Law Journal. I'm Christopher Naughton. And you know, just 50 years ago in this nation, we did not permit a black person to marry a white one in states such as Virginia. And then the Supreme Court changed that with just one case. Is this Supreme Court ready to do the same for same-sex couples? Gina Passarella with the Legal Intelligencer reports.
I say I think that marrying who you want to is a right that no man should have anything to do with. It's a God-given right, I think.
For many, it's hard to believe. Less than 50 years ago, in many states, interracial marriage was illegal. And then in 1967, the U.S. Supreme Court, and the aptly named Loving v. Virginia, changed all of that. Now, the current Supreme Court is taking up same-sex marriage. Is the nation ready to adopt a similar path taken in Loving v. Virginia?
Well, that depends on who you talk to. You know, proponents of same-sex marriage will tell you it's exactly like a Loving v. Virginia situation. There are other people, some people who are proponents of same-sex marriage and some people who are opponents, who say, well, hold on.
Two same-sex issues are being considered by the court: the constitutionality of DOMA, the Federal Defense of Marriage Act, and Proposition 8, the California law banning same-sex marriage, which was recently struck down by a federal appeals court. If this Supreme Court reviews only the DOMA cases,
they don't do what many people think that they will do, which is solve the problem of same-sex marriage for everyone.
If the Supreme Court were to rule that DOMA is unconstitutional, in that case, it would mean that the federal law has to recognize those state marriages, but it wouldn't mean that the states that don't recognize same-sex marriage now have to.
Taking up the Prop 8 matter would likely have a more far-reaching impact.
The California case, if it were brought before the Supreme Court, could settle the issue for the whole country.
But that's unlikely to happen. The conventional wisdom is, don't expect the kind of sweeping change seen in landmark cases Brown v. Board, Roe v. Wade, or the aforementioned Loving v. Virginia. In each of those decisions, the Supreme Court dictated new law for all states to follow.
None of these cases resolve the issue of same-sex marriage. None of them do.
I believe there's momentum in favor of same-sex marriage. I believe if you look 10, 15 years from now and the court doesn't intervene, that there will be more and more states that approve it. But we're not there yet like we were in 1967 with interracial marriage.
As with so many areas of the law, a court ruling on this issue could create just as many questions as it gives answers. There's certainly momentum in the country to legalize same-sex marriage, but there aren't as many state laws in place as there were back in the days of Loving v. Virginia, when the Supreme Court okayed interracial marriage. Where that momentum and the law will meet is a question that may have constitutional scholars and the country talking for quite some time. For the American Law Journal, I'm Gina Passarella.
Well, there is no longer any suspense. The Supreme Court is going to review same-sex marriage. The question now becomes, how will they handle it? Three guests weigh in tonight. Let's go ahead and meet them. John Culhane is a professor of law and director of the Health Law Institute at Widener University School of Law. He is co-author of this book, Same Sex Legal Kit for Dummies. It's now in both ebook and in print publication. Tom Snyder joins us with Einhorn Harris. It is New Jersey's largest family law practice, and he filed an amicus brief before the New Jersey Supreme Court on behalf of the New Jersey State Bar Association regarding a same-sex New Jersey couple seeking the legal right to marry. And Professor Laura Little joins us this evening with Temple University Beasley School of Law. She is a professor of constitutional law and other areas as well, and she is a former clerk for Supreme Court Chief Justice William Rehnquist. I just want to show you a very short clip from a documentary that came out a few years ago on Loving v. Virginia. This is the landmark case that granted interracial couples the right to marry.
What is fundamentally important, though, is we ask the court to decide that a state may not pass a law which proscribes marriage between two consenting, competent adults based on race alone.
On June 12, 1967, the Supreme Court issued their ruling. In a rare unanimous decision, the court ruled 9-0 in favor of the Lovings. The opinion of the court, written by Chief Justice Earle Warren, was specifically directed at the Virginia anti-miscegenation statutes. We have consistently denied the constitutionality of measures which restrict the rights of citizens on account of race. There can be no doubt that restricting this freedom to marry solely because of racial classifications violates the central meaning of the Equal Protection Clause.
If we looked at some of the words that Earl Warren used in that case, and we simply substituted the words same-sex couples instead of interracial couples, aren't we really talking about what is essentially the same issue? And how could a court find any differently for same-sex couples as it found for Loving versus Virginia in 1967?
I think they're different cases. First of all, we're at a different point in history with respect to how the laws have changed, how the state laws have changed. As to same-sex marriage, we're still at the beginning of what may be a quick change, but we're at the beginning of it. Loving versus Virginia came at the other side of the curve. There were only 16 or so laws left that were prohibiting interracial marriage. It's also dealing with race, and the particular provisions of the Constitution that were relied on in Loving versus Virginia, which would also be relied on in this case, were specifically designed to deal with issues of race.
Mm-hmm. Are we at a Loving versus Virginia moment in the United States, John Culhane?
Maybe, and I guess we'll find out what the court thinks about this, but I agree with Laura that currently we still have a majority of states. I guess I don't think we're at the beginning, but we're certainly not as far along as we were with Loving versus Virginia. And so we still have a majority of states, actually a majority of states that still have constitutional state amendments that ban same-sex couples from marrying. And some of those amendments go further and say that same-sex couples can't even enter into civil unions. So this would be jumping ahead. The other point that I think is worth noting is that the court starts with a definition of marriage in its head, right? This sort of deep idea of what marriage means. And to them, it seemed like you were just excluding people that were otherwise qualified to marry. It's not so clear until the court says so directly that it regards same-sex marriages in quite the same way. So I think it might be regarded differently in that sense as well. Just kind of a deep definitional difference that the court might still have in its deep cortex, if you will.
Well, let's take a look at this schematic that the LA Times printed up some months ago. And I think what it shows is the evolution of not just same-sex marriage, but all of those permutations of partnerships that we have seen that have, you know, become part of our consciousness in this nation since the year 2000. Again, at the very beginning, you see that there's maybe one light purple state moving towards some same-sex marriage or partnership recognition. And then there's kind of a blowback, if you will, and as you see this maturing over time, all of a sudden we're starting to see very dark purple, meaning greater and greater rights accorded to people seeking same-sex marriage and civil unions. And on the other side, many states that have changed their constitution. Laura, at the very least, we're at loggerheads here. We're really at a place of critical mass, one way or the other.
We are. That's correct. And the other complication that we have here that we didn't have with, for example, Loving versus Virginia, is that the federal government has gotten into the game. The federal government passed a statute about 20 years ago, the Defense of Marriage Act, which takes a position on same-sex marriage, number one, from the point of view of federal law, but also from the point of view of how states relate to each other on whether or not they'll recognize same-sex marriages celebrated in another state.
And Tom, that's what's created headache for you and family law practitioners. I mean, the cornerstone of the domestic relations area of practice, of domestic relations law, is full faith and credit. That means that if someone gets married in New York and they move to New Jersey and they've got a divorce issue or a custody issue, you know that you can say, well, New York acknowledged that you were married, you're married. It's kind of mucked it up, though, for family law practitioners when it comes to same-sex partnerships.
It definitely poses a challenge to family practitioners. But, you know, the other thing is this, really poses a challenge to people who have a right to have some consistency and knowledge as to what rights they're entitled to in formulating their relationships and in setting issues with respect to their finances, their children, rearing their children. It's not fair to these people who have no real clear indication of what their rights are. You could be in one situation in New York City and cross the border into New Jersey less than 3 miles away, and your rights are completely different.
So is this a matter of pragmatics? I don't mean to take the humanity out of this issue, and maybe that's part of this history-making moment, but isn't it a matter of pragmatics for the practitioner as well, such as yourself.
You know, listen, how many cases, the thing about family law is not a lot of cases go up to the federal level in the family part. So this is something all family practitioners are watching, because what happens in these different states and what happens on the federal level, you've got to be ready to react and counsel your clients in terms of how to address issues with respect to adoptions, with respect to benefit rights in terms of pension, retirement accounts, with respect to deductibility of alimony in the event of a dissolution. There are so many intricacies that come into play here. You really have to be on top of your game and seeing what's coming down the pike.
But really, there are two issues that the Supreme Court can consider here. One deals with DOMA, the Defense of Marriage Act, a federal statute. The other one deals with Prop 8, which came out of California just a few years back. The California Supreme Court said that same-sex couples could marry in that state. And then Proposition 8 was a vote by the citizens of the state of California who said, no, you can't. This issue of same-sex marriage may come down to which case the Supreme Court takes. Is it going to be a DOMA case? Almost certainly it's going to be. Or is it going to be Prop 8? What's at stake here? Tell the people what's at stake.
Well, so for Prop 8, if the court were to take the Prop 8 case, there are really three different things they could do. One is to say that laws that that don't allow same-sex couples to marry on the same terms as opposite-sex couples are unconstitutional. That would be sort of the brass ring for marriage equality advocates, right? At the other side, they could just say, no, Prop 8 is fine, that there's no constitutional right for same-sex couples to marry. What I suspect they would do is something in between, and it's kind of a difficult needle to thread, but what they could do is adopt the reasoning of the Federal Court of Appeals in the Prop 8 case, which said that because of the way that Prop 8 was enacted, it really showed that there was animus toward gay and lesbian couples. And the way that they got to that conclusion was because in California, right, before the California Supreme Court's decision, you had full domestic partnership, which basically conferred all of the same rights on same-sex couples. And so what the Ninth Circuit said is the only reason to take that away, right, or to take away marriage and to return to domestic partnership, okay, is because you don't really like gay and lesbian people. You don't think their relationships are equal or as good. Mm-hmm. That's not a good enough reason. And the court really leaned on a Supreme Court case called Romer against Evans. So that might be a way to appeal to Justice Kennedy, who wrote that case,
okay,
and to basically say, you know, under these circumstances, and only these circumstances, you can't disqualify same-sex couples from marrying. So there is a way to do it.
I do agree that if the court took that Prop 8 case, that it would likely go the Romer versus Evans path, as you described, the more narrow path. This is a court that likes narrow rulings, mm-hmm, and not thunderbolts thrown into, yes, the American public. Mm-hmm. There is another case before the court that they possibly could take from Arizona that presents the state issue. It also has a narrow, possibly narrow disposition, but I think it's much more likely that the court's going to take the more minimal path,
right,
and
because
deal with the federal
if
law
I may
issue.
Take out a famous case coming back from the 70s, which everyone's heard of, Roe versus Wade, where basically the Supreme Court said to all states, you cannot deny a person's right, a woman's right to have an abortion, in broad brushstrokes. If this court takes the Prop 8 case, they more or less...
Or the Arizona case.
Okay, they would more or less tell the states, you cannot deny same-sex couples the right to marry. Not civil unions, not partnerships, the right to marry. It seems like the less onerous path, especially for this Supreme Court, is to take the DOMA case, because that would give the states some leeway, as if we had had a law passed in the 1970s that said, abortion's not illegal in a state where a state chooses to make it legal, but we're not going to force the states to make it legal. Doesn't this court have the same sort of choice before it based on the case that it takes?
Yes, it does. And one of the things that happened with Roe versus Wade that I'm not sure the court anticipated is it pitted the courts against the state legislatures. Mm-hmm. And there was a cat and mouse game between state legislatures and courts as to what kind of laws would pass constitutional muster
and
which wouldn't.
And it's still going on, right?
It's still going on. Mm-hmm. And to do it on the, and to decide the same-sex marriage issue in a small way on the basis of federal law would avoid that cat and mouse game.
David Boies, who's arguing this case, or actually argued the Prop 8 case in California, he teamed up with Ted Olson. They were adversaries in Bush v. Gore. They teamed up on the same side and said California citizens should have the same-sex rights should be accorded to those citizens. David Boies was saying recently, I think the Supreme Court is going to take the Prop 8 case. Maybe, of course, he'd like to see it that way.
Right.
But he said something very interesting, and I think this is a great part of legal history, that without a case that came out of the 2000s, Lawrence v. Texas, we would not be where we are today. In a word or two, let's go to law profs, and then we'll ask Tom Snyder to join us. What was Lawrence v. Texas all about, and why is that important to the discussion we're having today?
Lawrence dealt with a criminal statute that was focused just on homosexual sodomy. And the Supreme Court struck that down on the basis of a part of the 14th Amendment, the Due Process Clause, that's actually not at issue in the cases that are before the court today on same-sex marriage.
Right.
But the court did say that, in fact, this criminal prohibition against this very private act was unconstitutional.
Right.
But I think that was the holding. But there is so much language in that decision by Justice Kennedy that really validates and recognizes the sort of intimate decisions and private lives that people have. And now the court does say twice that this is a different issue from whether the court has to give any legal recognition to this union.
Right.
And it specifically kind of brackets that off.
Yes.
But if you read that decision and the way it talks about people being entitled to space and privacy and autonomy for their most personal decisions and ties it to this whole line of cases about marriage and procreation, you can read this case as much broader than what the court actually held. And that, I think, must be what Mr. Boies is referring to when he says that Lawrence against Texas really changed the landscape in some way. I think that's right.
And there's plenty of language in Lawrence versus Texas that the court could use today to support a recognition of same-sex marriage.
And in fact, state courts have used that line. Mm-hmm. For example, in Goodridge, which was the first state Supreme Court decision out of Massachusetts that required the state of Massachusetts to afford marriage equality to same-sex couples. Later that same year, as Goodridge, as Lawrence, rather, the court is already citing Lawrence. So it's powerful stuff.
I'm sorry, John.
If deployed in that way.
If Lawrence v. Texas, however, the Supreme Court, in essence, overturned itself. Now, I know not on the same basis, but in 1986, and this was a year before you were clerking for Chief Justice Rehnquist, the Supreme Court found in Bowers v. Hardwick that a sodomy statute was constitutional in Georgia. Going down the track 17 years later, the Supreme Court, for different reasons, albeit for different reasons, reversed itself. Now, there are three judges or justices who were on that Bowers v. Hardwick court, right? Rehnquist was one of them, Stevens was another, and O'Connor. They flipped their own decision 17 years later. O'Connor really flipped her vote, I know, for different reasons. But there are examples where the Supreme Court, over the arc of time, will reverse itself.
They looked at the evidence. They said they made a mistake. The other thing that's of pertinence is that in Lawrence versus Texas, the court said, you know, the legal landscape has changed. The states have started to show much less criminalizing of this behavior and much more acceptance of this conduct. So that kind of change among the state governments is the type of thing that the court looks to in evaluating whether to recognize constitutional guarantees.
As a pragmatic matter, and it all really does get down to pragmatics at the end, 51% of Americans now say that they are not opposed to same-sex marriage. In the last election cycle, just about every issue, went in an LGBT direction. Let's put it that way. Three states okayed same-sex marriage, right? Washington, Maine, and Maryland. Right. Minnesota would not amend its constitution and bar same-sex marriage. So, all of that moved in a positive direction, at least from an LGBT standpoint. And I think we have our first openly gay senator, Tammy Baldwin, right? So what do politics have to do with the court, after all, at the end of the day? And doesn't it have to do a lot with the court?
Well, the court, on the face of its opinions, refers to changes in the public attitudes. There's many justices on the court that believe that the Constitution should reflect contemporary views, that it's an evolving document, so that a movement like that can be seen as a reason why the constitutional norms need to be modified. But it's a double-edged sword. That is, the justices may say, this seems to be working its way out through the state political process. Maybe it's better to stay our hand and see how the states work it out.
Tom, what do you think about that?
Well, you know, in New Jersey, you know, they had the Assembly pass it, they had the Senate pass it, the governor vetoed it. Next time, maybe they override the governor's veto. Maybe next time the governor passes the bill. But it's moving in that direction. It's moving with the trend, with the rate, with the rest of the country. And that's exactly what I was speaking in terms of sensitizing the community towards passing these types of laws.
Another way you do that is by moving from civil unions. Well, that would be the case in New Jersey. But in places like Vermont and New Hampshire, they first had civil unions to get people kind of used to the idea that same-sex couples could have the same rights and the earth wouldn't collapse and the, you know. And then a few years later, they went to full marriage equality. So that's what at least one professor has called equality practice, is moving toward equality sort of in a way that gives people a chance to accustom themselves to it, just like someone coming out to a family has to give the family some time to get used to it. It's a similar sort of dynamic.
You know, talk about interracial marriage. I mean, you know, gosh, Love and V, Virginia. Who would ever thought, you know, today's society, you know, to even think that there would be prohibitions to, you know, interracial marriage is my feelings are kind of bizarre. It's part of our common culture now. And I see that trend happening with respect to same-sex relationships as well.
All you have to do is look at the numbers of younger generations. They really don't care, or they're really actually for it, if you will.
Yep, and you know, in 20 years, we're going to look back, and a lot of commentaries have said, where are you going to be, you know, 20 years ago, where are they going to say Jersey was in terms of these rights? Are they going to look at New Jersey and say, how on the face of the earth could you deny same-sex couples the right to marriage? How archaic? Well, you know, we're in those times right now where those issues are decided, and they're going to look back at New Jersey or whatever state's involved and assess whether or not, you know, what were these people thinking? You know, that's going to be the question.
A couple of years ago, the Maine legislature passes a marriage equality law. The people veto it, okay, 53 to 47. This year, right, they don't even bother with the legislature. They go right to the people with a ballot initiative, and it's exactly reversed, 53 to 47 in favor of marriage equality. Why did that happen in such a short time? The ground game, as that's the expression of the day, right? But 300,000 doors were knocked on in the last couple of years by marriage equality advocates going door to door and making their case to the people. And I think, you know, you see what happens when those kinds of conversations take place. And the court, I realize I'm moving here from court to politics, but just to make the connection, the court could see this happening and say, the DOMA case is a different thing. There you've got a federal law. But when you're looking at states and what they're doing and how things are evolving, and that graphic you showed earlier, this kind of sweep toward purple, the court may want to give that more time to, as you said earlier, percolate, because that's what it's doing a nice job of doing.
The problem, though, as you say, is that in the meantime, it's chaos, right?
Right.
As Tom says, you get married in one state, you can't even get divorced in, and if you move, right? Because
right.
that you're for the purpose of that state, you're not even married.
Right.
And that's sort of torture to live with while there's this change if the court doesn't get involved. So one idea is that it's not getting involved to somehow mandate what types of relationships are appropriate or not as a matter of the Constitution, but simply trying to inject some uniformity into what is a union that's having a lot of trouble with the different states. And
so
the
court looks at the pragmatics, they see the chaos, so they realize, okay, we've got to help family law attorneys and all the families that get in, you know, are going to be impacted by these laws and these myriad of laws and civil unions and partnerships and marriage and that sort of thing. But beyond that, judges are acutely aware of what the American public is thinking. And I don't think they want to be that out of step with the American public. Do you think that there's any merit to that argument at all?
I think from the face of the opinions that you can see in the reproductive rights area or in the sexual activity privacy area, the courts are willing to refer to changes in public opinion more than they are in other contexts.
I think one of the problems with if the Supreme Court goes down the Prop 8 road is then, and the question is always, what's next? Are we talking about heightened scrutiny? Are we talking about protected class status? Are we talking about Title VII protections where you can't discriminate against someone because of their race, because of their cultural background, because of their religion, could sexual orientation. And I know a lot of, you know, some cities and some, I don't think any states have, maybe I'm wrong there, but some cities and locales have, you know, changed their charters and said you cannot discriminate based on sexual orientation. But you have to think, John, that that's maybe what this court is thinking as well. If all of a sudden same-sex marriage is something that every state must adhere to, now doesn't that start changing Title VII?
Or sort of state anti-discrimination laws, you know, sort of what does that say about the rest of the law, I think is a fair question. That really hasn't been sufficiently addressed. I mean, I think you're talking about a public right when you're talking about same-sex marriage as opposed to private, you know, discrimination laws, right? So you
and
might have a different...
something that the court has said is a fundamental right.
That's right. That's right. So it could be treated differently. But there are concerns by some of those who oppose marriage equality that it will lead to these other kind of unintended consequences. And I think there is a clear analytical difference. Whether that translates into a political difference, I think, is maybe the more interesting question.
All right, it's crystal ball time. And none of us here are prognosticators, but oh well. We're still going to have to take a stab here. What do you think the Supreme Court is going to do, John?
I think they'll take the DOMA case only. I think they'll take one of the two cases from either the First or the Second Circuit. I think they'll find that DOMA violates the Equal Protection Clause of the U.S. Constitution. And I think they'll throw it out. I don't think they'll take the Prop 8 case.
Okay. But you think that they're going to overturn that? In other words, circuit courts and district courts have already overturned sections of DOMA.
I think they will affirm.
They will affirm that.
That's right.
Those courts overturning those particular sections of the Defense of Marriage Act.
That's my 2-cent prediction.
So you think that they're going to move, in your perspective, they're going to move along, but incrementally here.
I think that will commend itself to them as the safest course, and I think that's okay. Therefore what they'll do.
Okay, I'm in your corner. What do you think, Professor?
I agree. although I'm maybe less sure as to the ultimate disposition of the DOMA case, I think that if the court does strike down DOMA, it will do it on the basis of uniformity and the need for uniformity rather than on the basis of any sort of judgment about the particular relationship, that it will try to dodge that bullet if it can.
Okay. And Tom, if they do overturn that segment in DOMA, they're not going to get the uniformity that they're really seeking, are they?
No, not at this point. And I imagine that it will result in continuing challenges to states discriminating on a state-by-state basis.
And so do you think personally that that's what this court is going to do?
We shall see.
I want to thank my guests for joining us tonight in a saga that will continue to unfold. John Culhane from Widener School of Law and the author of the book Same Sex Legal Kit for Dummies, now in both ebook and in print. Thomas Snyder with Einhorn Harris, the largest family law practice in the state of New Jersey. And I'd like to thank Professor Laura Little for joining us tonight from Temple University Beasley School of Law, professor of constitutional law. And thanks all, one and all, for joining us tonight. So for all of us here at the American Law Journal, thanks for joining us this week. And until next week, case closed.
This week's American Law Journal has been made possible in part by Blank Rome, providing strategic advice for employers in today's workplace. King Spry, serving its Pennsylvania clients in family law, business, personal injury, and school law for over 30 years. Beatty, Sloan, and DeGeneva, personal attention for those hurt at work or suffering from serious injury. Leventhal, Sutton, and Gornstein, we have your Social Security disability case covered. Martin Banks, we wrote the book on workers' comp law. Einhorn Harris, a long-standing community law firm with the largest family law practice in New Jersey. Polonsky and Polonsky, former U.S. government counsel, representing those seeking Social Security disability benefits. Hahalis and Canupas, representing employees wronged at work. Scheller PC, protecting consumer rights since 1977. And the Legal Intelligencer, the nation's oldest legal newspaper for lawyers.